यू नो वी आर ऑल सिटिंग इन द हॉल, दिस हॉल का नाम है कौटिल्य एंड चाणक्य गो टुगेदर, लैंड ऑफ बिलियन ड्रीम्स एंड सस्टेनेबल ड्रीम्स, अर्थशास्त्र द साइंस एंड द स्टेट क्राफ्ट ऑफ द 4th century BC. Kautilya informs people that time with this angle, the angle of environment, about rainfall patterns and the soil types and the relevant that are even relevant today. Now, how the business of climate, what we have made it today, was relevant in the times that we never imagined. So Chanakya also talked about environment those years ago. Today, post lunch, we are here to talk about the bonds, the James Bond, the green bond, the green bond that is like the James Bond today, and financial instruments, green financing, risk of green financing, and the future, what the future has hold for the sustainable world that we live in. Sustainable finances help us in the fight for sustainability. For the fight, we need tools. And for the tools, if we have the right toolbox, and if the toolbox has tools which are sharpened, as this wise man from the financial world get, things will happen. This is a revolution by itself, and shifting from finance, where from money, making money from money, from sustainability. The influence of ESG. ESG and sustainability go hand in hand. The right connect with the innovations and the funders. That's what is going to make this evolution, revolution more relevant. So, with these remarks, I would like to begin this, and I request that the speakers please introduce themselves in a minute. We know all your names, you are quite famous. We would like to know the impact that you would like to get. Madam.
Thank you so much. I'm Shipra, I'm the CEO of DRIVE, which is a science and technology cluster of the Principal Scientific Advisor to the Government of India. The purpose of the cluster is to create an ecosystem of industry, academia, and government bodies, and create a platform whereby innovations can be taken from lab to market. Now, the relevance of this platform and sustainability is that our key thematic areas of the four thematic areas that we delve in, sustainability is a major one. So one of the critical component that we do is we scout for technology solutions that kind of mitigate the environmental pollution problem and add to sustainability. I'll talk more about it later, passing it on.
Good afternoon, and first of all, I thank the organizers to really invite me to participate in this panel. I'm Manish Kumar. I head ESG and CSR initiatives at ICICI Bank. And, as my co-panelists mentioned, sustainability is now very much an integral part of whatever we do, we have to do. And it is here to stay. It is something that we have to take very seriously. So just to give you a sense, ICICI Bank has been publishing its sustainability report for the last 5 years. We have adopted the international frameworks as our journey to make the disclosures more and more sharper along the last 5 years. It is aligned to the Global Reporting Initiative framework, the GRI framework. We have aligned it to the TCFD requirements, and obviously being one of the top 1,000 listed entities in India, we have to also report the business responsibility and sustainability report required by the SEBI. As you, most of you might be aware, that there is a reasonable assurance requirement on some of the parameters which are known as the BRSR core parameters. So that is a compliance part. But in any case, we look at sustainability very seriously. We have embedded that into our own operations, as well as the kind of the business that we are doing is something that we are trying to make sustainable. So we can talk about it as we go along. I hand over to Rakhi.
My name is Rakhi Kulkarni. I lead and head ESG climate at GEF Capital Partners. What GEF does is essentially look at investments in climate mitigation and climate adaptation businesses. We are a growth stage private equity fund, which means we kind of fund those companies which require capital for their next phase of growth. So climate mitigation, adaptation clearly is very, very important and relevant today. Our typical investment sectors will range from renewables to electric mobility, low carbon transition solutions. In adaptation, it will include water security, food security, agribusinesses. Our focus geography has been South Asia, but primarily India. We have been around for many years now, and essentially finding the right kind of businesses and channeling the capital there is what we essentially do. So I really look forward to this conversation today. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Chetan Savla. I head sustainability and strategic projects at Kotak Mahindra Bank. Our journey, if I may talk about Kotak Bank's journey in sustainability, began around 2014 when business responsibility was still a voluntary requirement, and fast forward, CSR became a mandatory requirement, and we started putting our sustainability thoughts together to bring the four aspects of CSR, ESG, financial inclusion, and some aspects of priority sector lending into a common thought process which kind of encompassed sustainability. We are into our fourth year of now publishing our integrated report aligned to BRSR's standards as well as global standards. And we expanded our CSR program significantly to include a lot of sustainability-linked projects, not just in the usual areas of afforestation and lake rejuvenation, etc. But we did a major tie-up with IIT Kanpur, where we are setting up the Kotak School of Sustainability within IIT Kanpur. And we have done a project with a multi-year project with IIT Madras, where we are doing Kotak IIT Madras Save Energy Mission, where we are helping MSMEs to save energy and commercially gain from it. So those are some of the major initiatives. I really look forward to talking about some aspects about financing and sustainability in this session.
So please keep the mic. What's the industry frameworks are required to create a vibrant
So one of the things that we started when we started looking at sustainable financing as a as an identified subject, we said that let's first look at the end use, and the end use of capital expenditure which or capital requirement which is coming up on sustainable businesses or you know sustainable extensions of existing industries. One of the few key elements are that either they are ideas which have very high risk, and therefore there is a viability gap which needs to be filled with risk capital which you know is able to take that risk on outcomes. There are some areas like green hydrogen, etc., where the risk is so high that only a founder or a very large conglomerate is able to take that risk. There are some other areas where, you know, as Rakhi mentioned, private equity is able to take that risk, but it is still capital which can be provided only from equity side. Then there is finally, if you have to give competitive lending to sustainability projects, most financial institutions are finally only intermediaries. You get money from somewhere, you give money to somebody. So you need to have a source of capital which is also able to provide that economical capital which you are able to pass on to sustainability end users. And when we went about kind of trying to see you know what are the sources of that capital, they are surprisingly very few. Mostly capital is available at rates which would be available to non-sustainable projects as well. So what is the, you know, how do you make it more viable, or who fills in that cost gap? Finally, the money is going into either a replacement of an existing manufacturing of one technology with another, or it is going into creation of new capacity which is not necessarily yielding disruptive benefits. So how do you finance that viability gap? Who pays the cost? That cost can come either from, you know, investors or liability providers who are essentially willing to take a bit of that hit on the returns that they get. They are very few and far between, including the green deposit initiatives which have commenced in India, or the green bond providers from offshore. There are some multilateral institutions and there are some philanthropy funds who are willing to fund in that gap, but otherwise it's usually available at commercial terms. Then the other place where this can be filled in is from the regulatory cap and trade mechanism. And that, to my mind, seems to be the best way of creating this financial instrument, which will provide the incentive which these industries require. The analogy that I really like to use over here is in banking, we have this, most of you may be aware, we have this concept of regulated minimum priority sector lending. And every bank is supposed to give 40%. But there are some banks who do more than 40, there are some who less than 40. And there is a trading mechanism which is provided by the Reserve Bank of India, where the surplus guys trade with the deficit guys. Same thing is happening in renewable energy certificates. And the same thing can very effectively happen to kind of bring in this viability gap funding to make the overall financing framework far more robust than it is today.
Raki, according to you, what is the perspective of the potential of green capital to a country like India?
The potential for green capital is very, very huge. I think let's look at today what India is committing to in terms of where it wants to transition in the green economy. So the government of India has already committed to a 2070 net zero target. We all are aware about it. Some of the key specific sectors that play an important role, obviously, is renewable energy. Electric mobility is there. Alternative fertilizers is something, in terms of improvement of soil health, nutrition is something that we are looking at. There are various policies that are coming in terms of green hydrogen policy, the national biofuel policy, amongst others. Circular economy, resource recovery is again a very, very critical area. I think the low carbon transition pathway that Government of India has laid out in terms of identifying which are the seven areas apart from this, talk about food security, water security as one of the key areas. Adaptation essentially in terms of even urban areas and how it kind of brings about resilience and adaptation to changing climatic sort of environments. I think to operationalize all of this, right? I mean, I think a huge amount of obviously capital, green financing is required, and also innovative financial instruments to actually make all of this happen. Today, reports suggest that the amount of green capital inflow that is required is perhaps six times much more that is required than what we have today. I think what again estimates are suggesting today is like between now and 2030, we require around $8.5 trillion of money that is will be required to kind of, enable this change. And from 2030 to 2070, even higher amounts, almost closer to $10 trillion US dollars per year cumulatively. So I think we are sitting on a huge amount of potential. I think what is important is, number one, how do you channelize this into the right businesses, right companies, right sectors? How do you risk-proof it with respect to ensuring that we risk-proof ourselves from greenwashing also at the same time? Ensuring that the entire economy thrives towards decarbonized kind of an economy and climate. Yeah.
Going further, Manish ji, the Indian banks and the green financing, how do we go from here?
I think both my co-panelists have already touched upon that. So it's more about, you know, availability of capital, which can actually be channelized by the banks into the required sector.
So how do you do that?
So the role that the bank plays, you know, as an intermediary is to do the risk assessment. And with regard to, if we are talking more about climate risk, of course, the banks are evaluating ESG risks as well as climate risk. So, you know, climate risk is one of the components of ESG risk. So E, which is the environment, is where the climate risk gets assessed. Climate risks actually play out in two forms. One is physical risk and second is the transition risk. So just to give you an example, like, you know, as you're aware, most of the lending by the banks is against a collateral. So if suppose it's a mortgage, then you have the house as a collateral, or if it's a vehicle loan, the vehicle is a collateral. A corporate loan would have the corporate assets, the plant and factory as a collateral. So one is the assessment of the risk associated with the location of the collateral. So we are aware of, you know, the frequency and the severity of climate events which are now happening, which can impact the value of the collateral which is available to the bank. And in case it is inadequate, then that exposes the bank in terms of the lending that they have provided, and which will lead to a higher capital allocation for the bank. So it's effectively a cost to the bank, which ultimately will have to be borne by the borrowers. So that is one of the risks that has to be assessed. So that is one area, assessing the physical risk associated with the collaterals that we hold. Second is assessing the physical risk in terms of sectors. So when we take a sectoral approach, so what is the kind of risk which probably an agriculturist may be exposed to? Because when we do agriculture lending, and as Chetan alluded to it, you know, we are mandated, there is a directed lending norm by the Reserve Bank of India. So if you look at a banking, at a bank level or the banking sector level, almost, you know, between 15% and 18% of our portfolio is actually to agriculturists. So that's an important area where we have to assess what kind of events could expose the agriculturists and impact their debt repayment capacity. So this is something that the banks are doing on ongoing basis. Now tools are available, which the banks are evaluating. At least I can talk about ICICI Bank. It is being evaluated. We are trying to see whether it is, you know, really relevant from an India context perspective. And the challenge that currently we are facing is, you know, whether can we actually create a forecasting model. A lot of the data points which are available is based on past events, but we are now realizing that actually the climate events are not really following a trajectory based on the past situations. So that is something that we are looking at. Second is the transition risk. So a lot of industries and sectors in India are transitioning towards low emitting technologies. They are trying to improvise their process so that they can become much more sustainable. So that is one area where we are working on. We are working with the borrowers. This is a sector-wise approach that we have taken, and we are trying to assess where they are in terms of their journey, in their maturity profile. Have they really committed to really becoming carbon neutral or net zero? Have they committed, you know, capex to really migrate into that sustainable situation? What is the kind of funding requirements? What is the kind of commitments that they are making? Again, Chetan mentioned about that. What is the kind of commitments they are making in terms of, you know, the equity or the catalytic capital which is required for some of those projects to happen. So right now we are in a phase of assessing the maturity in their journey, and basis that a lot of decisioning is being taken in the bank. So it's again a journey, things will evolve. One of the areas that we are closely waiting for is the climate finance taxonomy by the Government of India that will help us at least identify areas and sectors where we need to lay more focus on in terms of assessing these.
Shipra, basic question. The question is, you are a link between the SMEs and the government to the outside world, the finance. So the question is this: financial hurdles, and what do the SMEs and the startup space, and how to bring about this dialogue and make a good start? Start is there. How to take it maturely?
Thank you so much, Samir. And just I'll help you a little bit in terms of explaining where I fit in the entire discussion, because that's the missing link you're talking about. I think, when Chetanji was, talking, he very well explained about his problems of the underlying projects, right, that are associated. Here we are talking about the financial instruments, right, the risk and reward associated with the financial instruments. But what is the underlying asset? The underlying asset in this context would be technologies that actually mitigate the environmental risk. For example, if we take the case of an EV, as you'd mentioned, right? EVs are only so much environmentally friendly as long as they don't take the primary source of power from the grid, which unfortunately is not happening, right? So one of the interventions that can be drawn from technological progress was integrating the charging infrastructure with solar panels, which we were discussing. So that at least if not wholly, partly that off-grid solution is there, and there's a transition to green energy, right? Now, where a platform like DRIVE fits in, which is a science and technology cluster, is actually look for such technology interventions and such technology solutions, which could come either from the MSME segment, startups, or academia, from the research lab in academia. And work with various stakeholders. So we are kind of a triple helix ecosystem, where one of the stakeholders is the government bodies, and again all tiers of government bodies, right, from central government agencies, ministries, to state level bodies, to administrative public authorities that actually execute these kind of projects, right? So that is one vertical. Another vertical is the industry, where, again, the entire range from startups to MSMEs to corporates to PSUs, they come into the picture. And the third aspect of it, which is the core, is the kind of academia, the research labs, where the innovations get born. And there are experts that can help co-create with the industry based on their needs. Right. So bringing all these people together, DRIVE serves as a landing platform, kind of source use cases. So one use case I already mentioned in terms of the EV example. Another one is rejuvenation of water bodies, right? So right now there are multiple solutions, but again, going into the depth of more, science-based technological solutions, phycoremediation is another example that I gave, which being a nature-based solution is more cost-effective and can be taken to rejuvenate, small water bodies, to rivers, to anything, right? And the same can be applied to leachate, to oil sludge, even at that level, right? Providing massive benefits, both in terms of cost and in terms of reducing the time to kind of break down and, come up with the end product. So, long story short, DRIVE or any S&T cluster that has been created by the PSA office serves as that landing platform where right from solution scouting based on the kind of use cases we've received from government agencies, PSUs, industry, to kind of helping co-create further if more product development is required, more commercialization is required with the industry, to deploying it with local public authorities, PSUs, etc., and then scaling it up further based on the success at national level because of the reach that we have, because of the pedigree that we have. So making it a national level implementation program, that is where a science and technology cluster comes in.
Yeah, but the question of mine, what are the hurdles you see at the ground level when the money of funds comes?
Yeah. So, Samir, if you ask my honest opinion, and in my previous life, I have been in banking in London throughout, and I have seen the evolution of these financial instruments in London very, very closely, right? So, we are working very hard as a nation to work towards, creating these, carbon-borne or green credit markets. But what is missing is a robust pipeline of these underlying assets. Again, going back to the point that Chetanji raised and Rakhi also mentioned, right? So first, we need these indigenously developed, solutions that are there for the industry to adopt. Otherwise, it again becomes the case of just replacing kind of manufacturing lines from existing products to new products, and So, and that will take time to develop.
Rakhi, in what way do SME contribute to a low carbon economy, and what do you feel are the interventions needed to enable this ecosystem?
Sure, I think so. SMEs today form a very, very strong and a large backbone of our economy, right? I mean, today, if you just kind of look at some of the statistics that we have, India today has roughly around, 60 odd million MSME sector across, of which almost, and they contribute to almost 30 to 40% of the GDP, 40% of it is going into your exports markets. Their consumption of energy is also high. Approximate energy consumption, if you kind of compare it to some of the large scale industries, is the energy consumption is somewhere around 25%. They are also a significant emitter of greenhouse gas emissions. So it's estimated that it's around 100 odd metric tons of carbon dioxide, a million metric tons of carbon dioxide getting emitted because of fossil fuel consumptions, because of certain you know, production related practices, etc. And in terms of the workforce that they employ, that's, it's a very, very significant, a large number of workforce that today MSMEs employ. So in terms of where we have, they form a significant part of the entire decarbonization story. They are also part of significant supply chain for larger corporates and industries, right? Most of the scope 3 emissions, when we talk about net zero and we talk about decarbonization, a large part of emissions and scope 3 emissions are sitting within this sector and this area, and that's very, very critical to sort of tackle. What are some of the challenges and barriers there? I think understanding of what needs to be done in that sector, technical capability, access to finance, some of the most enabling policy, perhaps regulatory environment, a little bit of willingness to sort of, you know, take that extra step and go beyond. I think these are all sort of today some of the barriers that we see. In addition, I think today, small and medium scale enterprises are also sort of disproportionately vulnerable to some of the climate risk, which even I think Manish also mentioned, both physical risk as well as transition risk. So if you are part of the supply chain where you are vulnerable to, let's say, unusual rainfall patterns, droughts, or, you know, and if your supply chain gets affected, impacted, this is the sector which will be largely sort of vulnerable to it. If today you have transition risk in the form of, let's say, changing policy environment, regulatory environment, markets, access to markets, again, MSMEs in some form or shape are going to get impacted. Today, I think with the European Union coming with the CBAM regulations, I think it's finally all trickling down to the last mile in terms of what we need to change there, so that we kind of, you know, address some of these emerging requirements and regulations. So I think this forms a very, very critical part, component of the entire decarbonization process. I think enabling policies, a more supportive regulatory and conducive environment is needed so that they are able to sort of tide over some of the struggles towards climate transition. That is required, and I think again, a lot of technical capability. We also see, because we have been looking at some of the companies in the medium enterprises around in that sector, I think strong ESG practices is also something that is being looked at when, if you have to attract quality capital, right? What are your labor working conditions? What is your over and above the basic compliance norms, how do you sort of address environmental social governance aspects? And if you kind of channelize all of this, I think you, with the right kind of financial innovative instruments, there's a lot that can be done within the MSME sector. I think that's a very, very critical and important part.
Thank you. Manishji, what about the approach that need to be developed to assess the risk that is involved?
So I spoke about you know, the nature of the risks. The approach basically is, you know, we have to depend a lot right now on the information which is either available in the public domain. So the business responsibility sustainability report does give us a lot of information, at least for the top 1,000 listed entities. Through them we reach out to the, you know, the value chain that Rakhi just spoke about, and we try to assess the risks associated you know, in their business. That is one way. Second is that we are reaching out to the borrowers. We have identified certain sectors, what we, you know, commonly call as hard to abate sectors, and try to assess what those companies you know, are doing in terms of the risks which can potentially disrupt their businesses. We are trying to see whether they are getting impacted due to policy initiatives. Are they getting impacted due to situations like carbon tax, the CBAM in EU, or you know, which is coming up in the UK? You know, how are they getting impacted due to you know, the newer technologies which are getting adopted by their competitors as well? Can they pose? Can they really collaborate and really work together? So those are the kind of you know, approaches that we are taking. We are also working with a lot of you know, external partners who have information available. So we have rating agencies, we have secondary research available through which we are able to get much more information. And that is the approach that we are taking. There is also, you know, the areas which have been identified as sustainable, which qualify as sustainable financing. So for example, in India, we have the Sovereign Green Bond Framework, which kind of gives an indication of what qualifies as green financing, social financing. So those are the areas when we lend to, we do enhanced due diligence. We take support of sustainability experts in trying to really keep monitoring some of the sustainability covenants that may be required to ensure that the corporate is able to really go down that sustainability journey which they would have committed as part of some of the projects for which they are seeking financing. So there are various you know, approaches that are available, which depending on the nature of the industry, nature of the borrower, and the feasibility, techno-economic viability is what we are looking at.
Thank you. Last concluding remarks, 30 seconds. The wish and why we are here today. So what do we need to achieve in the next 5 years?
So I think one important thing which is required is more collaboration. This again can be at various levels. You know, it is from a policy perspective, there needs to be much more collaboration amongst the ministries. There needs to be much more collaboration amongst the industrialists. If they are working in the same sector, can they really you know, share information about the technologies that they are using, what is upcoming? There has to be much more collaboration in the, you know, the financial sector, the lending community. You know, can we really look at practices which are you know, relevant from an industry sector? There needs to be much more collaboration in, you know, external service providers. I think that is one important area which can help us in this journey.
I think one burning remark that I have is, you know, most of the discussion from the financing side has been focused on how to mitigate the risk arising out of climate, right? I think we also, you know, as an industry segment, we also need to focus on creating a source of, you know, pool of funds to dabble with or invest in technologies that will actually help mitigate this climate risk. You know, one of the, you know, pointers that was raised earlier was which entity will take that risk of transitioning to green technology. I don't think the onus lies on one single entity or type of, you know, stakeholder. I think it's the responsibility of the entire industry or us as a community to kind of pool up and absorb that risk and allow, you know, scientific solutions to come up. And, you know, I would really love to, you know, see a kind of a public, private-public partnership in this regard, where part of the funding is put by the government and part is put by the industry. And, you know, a kind of a sandboxing platform is created for these technologies to be tested and taken forward.
Just maybe one last word would be pace and speed. I think that's what is important for it to really fasten the adoption of green finance mitigation.
Chetanji.
I think finally the economic motivations for getting this whole investment up and going and making sustainability sustainable, the economic motivations to be infused are very important. And I think that can at this juncture primarily come from government incentives, from cap and trade mechanisms, and potentially from you know, motivations like, for example, one of the ideas was, can sustainability lending be priority sector lending, can be classified as priority sector lending. So the regulatory framework around it, the cap and trade trading market mechanism, and direct incentives, I think for a period of time till which it becomes and attains a certain level of size, and then the flywheel will kind of turn on its own.
Thank you so much. You know, just summing up in a few lines, sustainability is there for a better planet, to lessen the waste or reduce the carbon footprint or the plastic footprint. I come from the plastic industry, the most used, abused, hated, but yet to remain here for some time till we find a replacement. Now, I just leave a message that making sustainability sustainable is what we all have to do. And on a positive remark, catalyzing our goals, our dreams, and our efforts for a future more exciting and brilliant than what we live in today. Thank you.